So now we're going to discuss an allylic site reaction called conjugated hydrohalogenation. So for conjugated hydrohalogenation to take place, we're going to need a double bond and a strong halohydric acid like HCl or HBr, okay? Now, we're going to run into a problem though, because if you guys recall, there's already a reaction that happens between a double bond and HX. Do you guys remember what that is? It's an addition type reaction where, if you guys recall, a double bond is nucleophilic and HX is always highly electron deprived. So you're always going to get, or very easily going to get, the formation of basically a carbocation and a Markovnikov addition. So let's just go through this mechanism really quick so you guys can remember what this mechanism is. Remember that your double bond would hit the H. Now you have two choices. We could either place the carbocation on the primary or on the secondary carbon, and we would definitely choose the secondary because that's the Markovnikov addition, right? That's the Markovnikov carbocation. And from there, that carbocation could rearrange if it was unstable. In this case, we're not going to have a rearrangement possible, but it's something you have to think about anytime you make a carbocation. And then you would get your X negative attacking to form an alkyl halide. All right, a Markovnikov alkyl halide. So I'm just going to put here Mark alkyl halide is our product. Okay, now remember that the name of this reaction is simply hydrohalogenation. Okay, so if I say the word hydrohalogenation, I'm talking about a double bond attacking HX. So what's different about hydrohalogenation and conjugated hydrohalogenation? They sound so similar, and in fact the reagents look very similar, but there's a huge difference. Let me show you. Well, remember that in the mechanism for hydrohalogenation, you always get rid of the double bond. You start off with a double bond, you make a carbocation, and now that double bond is gone forever, okay, until you do an elimination reaction later, okay? But notice that for conjugated hydrohalogenation, we keep one double bond around because you're always going to start off with a diene, okay? So instead of starting off just with one double bond, you're always going to start off with two. What does that mean? That means one of the double bonds attacks the HX, and one of them is left over to participate in conjugation. Does that make sense? That's the big difference here, that we still have an allylic position after the reaction has taken place. Now, really quick, I just want to interject and say that your textbook might not call this conjugated hydrohalogenation. There's a few different names for it. It could also be called hydrohalogenation of dienes. You might also see it called 1,2 versus 1,4 addition to dienes. These are all the same exact concept. Okay, in fact, if you ever see hydrohalogenation and allylic together, again, another way to say it. So notice that the biggest difference being that one of the double bonds is going to react, but one of them is going to stay left over. We're always going to be left with one left over, and that means that we're going to have a conjugated intermediate. Okay, now one kind of misconception that I want to take out of here is that you might be thinking about another reaction that's similar to this called allylic halogenation. And in allylic halogenation, you always had a radical initiator, okay? But keep in mind that this is not a radical reaction. This is a carbocation reaction, so we're not gonna have a radical initiator in this reaction. We're simply gonna rely on the fact that you have one double bond and a carbocation present, okay? Let's draw the mechanism really quick. So in this mechanism, what we would expect is that my HX is going to attack one of the double bonds. One of the double bonds will attack the HX, and it will form a carbocation. Now we have the choice of putting the carbocation on the primary or the secondary position. Obviously we're gonna choose secondary due to Markovnikov's rule, but also because it's allylic, and we know that allylic sites are always more stable than any other sites, than their respective, you know, types that aren't allylic, okay? So now we have that carbocation and we have an HX present, and you might already be, your wheels might be turning of what's gonna happen next. You're thinking this X negative is going to hit the positive charge just like always, just like a normal hydrohalogenation. You're exactly right, but there's one extra complication, which is that now this positive charge is actually conjugated, so we have to draw a resonance structure in this mechanism. That resonance structure is going to be of one arrow swinging open like a door hinge. So we're going to get now a double bond here and a positive charge here. Okay? So now we have two different reactive intermediates that we have to react, that we could possibly react with. And in general, we're going to react with both. Okay? So what you're going to notice is that the X negative has the option to attack that carbon, but it also has the option to attack this carbon. So you should be aware of the fact that two different products are possible. Let's go ahead and draw these. So one of the products would be an allylic halogen, okay, an allylic alkyl halide in that position. And another one would be an allylic halogen in that position. Now you'll notice that this looks very similar. If you're aware of the allylic halogenation reaction that uses radicals, this product looks very similar to the product that you would get before in using an allylic halogenation. However, the reaction is completely different and the mechanism is completely different because one of the reactions uses radicals and this one uses carbocations. So it's a very different situation. Now, let me go ahead and give you an extra set of tools to be able to understand these. We actually give these two different products different names based on where the halogen attacks, okay? In both of these cases, my hydrogen always attacked one of the carbons. We're going to say that the hydrogen attacked this carbon here and this carbon here. If you're wondering why I picked that carbon, look at the original mechanism. The original mechanism has this double bond attacking the H and the carbocation forming here, meaning that an H must have been attached to that carbon, okay? The site where the H attacks is called the one carbon. That's your number one carbon, okay? From there, we can continue to count carbons in order to determine where the halogen adds, okay? So as you could see, this halogen being right next to the, in the first product, this halogen being right next to the hydrogen would be considered two. So this would be what we call a 1,2 product. Okay, or a 1,2 alkyl halide product, okay? Because of the fact that your hydrogen and your halogen attacked right next to each other on the same double bond. Whereas we see that it's a little bit different. After you resonate, you get a different distance, right? So this still is my one carbon because no matter what, the HX still attack the same position. But now notice that 2, 3, this is now attached to the fourth position. So this product is called the 1,4 product. Okay? So it turns out that we don't always have to get an even mixture of both the 1,2 and the 1,4 product. You should be aware that they can form, but it turns out that there is a way to selectively favor one over the other. And the way we can do that is by using temperature control. So this is a type of reaction that can use temperature control to prefer one product over another. And in fact, you can get a very high yield of just one of the products if you use the correct temperature. So what are the temperatures we need to know? Well, the temperatures that we need to know are that temperatures above 40, so these are going to be hot temperatures, are going to favor the 1,4 product. Okay? Temperatures below 0 degrees Celsius, that's going to be really cold. Think about it. That's below freezing, right? Are going to favor the 1,2 product. Okay? Before I read off any of these other lines, I want to help you memorize this. How can you remember that 1,4 correlates to 40 or higher, 1,2 correlates to lower? I just think of the bigger number. So the hotter the temperature, I'm going to get the 1,4 product mostly. The lower the temperature, I'm going to get more of the 1,2. So even if you have no clue what's going on, you can at least remember that and use that as a memory trick on your exam. Okay? Now there's a few other words here that I haven't defined yet. Notice that I'm calling the 1,4 product the thermodynamic product. and I'm calling the 1-2 product the kinetic product, okay? This brings up a type of reaction called thermodynamic versus kinetic control. And this is actually a really important concept for organic chemistry. This is not the only reaction in organic chemistry that we've learned that uses thermodynamic versus kinetic control. So I'm going to assign an entire set of videos. I'm going to do an entire other set of videos just to explain that process, okay? So right now, I'm not actually going to define thermodynamic and kinetic because that will be for another video. What I'm really trying to do here is just get you to memorize it and get you to basically recognize when we're going to have different types of products, okay? So once again, since this is my 1-2 product, this would be my kinetic product. Kinetic. And since this is my since this is my 1-4 product, this would be my thermodynamic. Dynamic, okay? Now notice that in my original reaction, I had no temperature present, okay? So what happens if your professor doesn't give you a temperature? What do you think you do? Do you assume that it's 1-4? Do you assume that it's 1-2? No. If there's no temperature, so let's just add a bullet point, you know? This is good learning. If there's no temperature, then assume both products. Okay? So if your professor does not give you temperature information, it's probably somewhere between 0 and 40, and you have to assume that you're just going to get a mixture of products. Okay? No thermodynamic control, no kinetic control. So, guys, I'm going to go ahead and let you guys try to solve these. We'll start off with the first one. So go ahead and take some time to try to draw the product of that first one, and then I'll explain it, okay? Go for it.